Morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us today. I appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedules to be here to listen to this conversation about a very important topic. We will get started. I want to introduce to you the president of Hudson University, Dr. Robert Clark, and he has a few words he'd like to say.
I'm Bob Clark, and it's certainly our privilege to host you here on campus today for this important activity. It is part of our mission to be an educational resource, and we look at this as an opportunity to learn together as a community about a critical issue that we all confront. We also have this as part of our academic mission, being a school and an institution that provides a good number of healthcare professionals. Hudson, for those of you that are not familiar, has about 3,700 students. Approximately 1,500 of those students are pursuing degrees in the healthcare fields. And those include everything from psychology all the way through the doctorate in pharmacy, doctor of physical therapy, master's in occupational therapy, and these programs in nursing that are critical to our community's future are part of our mission. And as I went through our curriculum, as I prepared a few remarks and thoughts about what we're doing today, I had to write down the names of coursework because I'm not sure I would remember everything from pathophysiology to pharmacogenetics and biotechnology to pharmacodynamics to pharmacologic research, etc. All of these are to prepare our graduates for the world in which they're going to live. Here on our campus, we have a robust system of support for our students in terms of the outreach efforts, in terms of stress and other issues that certainly have impacted what we do in the academic community. What we know is that more college-age students today are impacted by stress and stress environments than ever before. When we look at the number of students that we provide counseling services to, we see that this has had a dramatic increase in the needs that the institution needs to provide to take care of the whole student and the student's health. This year following, we are constructing a $3 million student health center to help us be able to provide the facilities that these students need. And one issue that I would leave you with to thought and think about during this day is, in addition to those that are also in a substance abuse situation, there is another situation that the counseling services works diligently on related to substance abuse concerns, and that is the affected order. What we find that of those students that need counseling, approximately 30% of them are impacted by family members and their social network that also is impacted by a substance abuse, even if they themselves are not thereby impacted. So the broader issue is, how can we as a society deal with these issues and be proactive and preventative? So those are the things I certainly hope we have time to discuss today. We welcome you to campus, and at this time I turn it back to Tim Haas, our state director. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Clark. We appreciate the ability to have this meeting in such a fantastic facility, really. It's impressive and glad to be here. Next thing I'm going to do is introduce to you our panel. I'll just read you the names of the folks that are on there. If you have an agenda, you have their information already. But our panelists are Senator Angus King Jr., Bruce Poliquin, Congressman Poliquin, Kristen Terrio, Leonard Kay, John Gale, Rick Tyler, Damian Piquel, Dr. Trip Gardner, Troy Morton, Stephanie Nichols, Captain Christopher Bressani, Sheldon Wheeler, Lee Softley, Bruce Campbell, and Barbara Ford. And we thank you folks for agreeing to be with us today. We appreciate, the sacrifice and time and effort to get here and be part of this conversation. Right now, I'm going to turn it over to Senator King and ask you if you have any comments or questions. Just comments.
This is one of those very common times when I'm called upon
to be a member of a group to speak where every single member of the panel in the audience knows more about the subject than I do. So I'm not going to talk long. The first thing I want to say is just to welcome Ann here from Washington, from the Department of Agriculture. It means a great deal to us to have you here, to have you experience what we're experiencing here in Maine. This is her first visit to Maine, and hopefully the whole week, a couple of days, will not have to be in dark rooms, but you'll experience some of the beauty of Maine as well. This is a problem that I call it the most serious public health issue that I've seen in Maine in my lifetime. We're losing more than one person a day throughout the state, and particularly today we're focusing on the problem of substance abuse in rural areas. And it's important to remember that rural areas are not small urban areas. Rural areas are different, and they're different in their infrastructure and in their assets and in their resources. And so I hope the discussion today can focus on what it is that we can do, we collectively, the community, the state, the medical community, and the federal government can do collectively to deal with this horrible disease that is simply ravaging our state, families, and communities throughout. So I'm hoping that we're going to be able to talk about different models, models that have worked here in Maine and also across the country. Everything from law enforcement to one of the subjects I'm most interested in, prevention, as well as treatment and access to treatment. So I welcome, I think this is really a case where I'm from Washington and I'm here to help, actually has some meaning, and we're delighted to have you here. So with that, Tim, and thank you, Tim, for your leadership in putting this together.
You're welcome. Thank you, Senator Reid. We appreciate the fact that you're here with us today. Congressman Poliquin, I give you the same opportunity.
Thanks, Tim, very much. I appreciate it. if you folks have not heard, this is a real big deal that Ann is here. This is the fifth, I think the last, Ann, if I'm not mistaken, the fifth roundtable across the country. And the Department of Agriculture is now in this fight with everybody, and they're here specifically to talk about rural America. And about a third of our country, roughly, as we all know, live in rural America, but here in Maine, it's more than just an expansive plain in the Midwest. It's our little towns along the coast and so forth and so on. So we're delighted that you're here, Ann. We had a little bit of time to talk out back before we came here. My brother, who is a great guy, dealt with and struggled with substance abuse for 35 years, and Jim is no longer with us as a result. So this is really something our family's dealt with for a very long period of time. And I'll tell you, and one of the things I would love to have you take back with you, Ann, and your staff, as you know, is that urban America is very different from rural. One of the differences is that we all know everybody. So if you live in a small town in Maine or in Nebraska, one of the issues you gotta deal with if you have a loved one that's addicted is you're embarrassed. You're just embarrassed. He or she doesn't want to be addicted. They're struggling with this for their lives. Family members are trying to help, but you're ashamed. And one of the things that makes it so difficult in rural America is because when you go to the gas station or you go to Dunkin' Donuts, you know the people. Whereas if you're living in New York or Boston, you might not know the people three floors below you in your apartment building. So it becomes easier to come out and ask for help. It's more difficult in rural America because your neighbors now know that you have a family problem. So part of the solution here, I think, is making sure that the folks at the Department of Agriculture know that we believe there's a real difference between rural and urban. And one of the ways to do this, I think, is to have a centralized database that deals not only with Maine, and we're doing a better job with that in Maine, but also nationally, because if you don't want to come forward, you are more likely to look for help if you're not embarrassing yourself or other family members. And sometimes you can do that by accessing data. Second of all, we're very physical. Here in Maine, we're pulling traps, or we're working in the woods, or we're baling hay. We're a very physical state. Rural America is very physical. And as a result, we are much more susceptible to being hooked on painkillers. Whereas if you're in your urban areas, you're more clicking or whatever they do there, I guess, right? So that's a real big deal. And also, in one of the things I hope we talk about today, one of the things I want to make sure we leave with you when you go home, and your report's going to be very impactful in Washington, integrating with the DHHS and Border Security and Homeland and everybody else. One of the other things is that our rural hospitals that deal with this issue, among other issues, we are the least equipped and prepared to deal with this issue, but we have the highest incidence of opioid addiction. So the demand is high for their services, but they're the least equipped. And that's why I'd be very grateful if you could spread the good word why it's so important to make sure our veterans, and Angus, you and I worked on this, our veterans are able to get more of their health care where it makes sense, closer to home at these rural hospitals. So they don't have to drive 3, 4, 5 hours from Madawaska to Togas. That's critically important to keep these hospitals open with new patients. And we need to make sure the VA pays their bills to help keep these hospitals open. That helps everybody. Very, very, very important. And you mentioned, Ann, earlier, the incidence or the absence of high-speed internet broadband in rural America. Absolutely correct. It helps deliver healthcare services to our communities and those that are addicted, and also helps everybody else in the community. I also want to mention two other things quickly, if I can, Tim, and thank you for the time. Really, really important. I'm just going to be very blunt about this, and Angus, I know you're going to agree with me. The formula used in Washington to allocate funding for this issue tremendously disadvantages rural America. They do it based on population. We have a low population, so we get less money, but we're the folks that are getting hit with this epidemic. The incidence in rural America as a percent of our population is high, but we don't get the funding because it goes to urban America because the formula is based on population. That, Ann, is wrong. I've introduced legislation on this with Annie Custer from New Hampshire, a Democrat. I'm a Republican. We work with everybody. This is not political. It doesn't matter if you're a Republican, an independent, or a Green, if your family member dies from this. It does not make any difference. It's H.R. 5109. I know you have great staff here. H.R. 5109, Federal Opioid Response Fairness Act of 2018. It is now in the Energy and Commerce Committee, Angus, down there. So it hasn't hit the floor yet, but I want you to make sure that you know about that, Ian. I appreciate it. And lastly, border security. 80% of the cheap, potent heroin, $10 bag stuff that's laced with fentanyl or whatever else is in there,
they kill you in one overdose. 80% of that stuff comes over the border to Mexico.
That's why I've been so tough on border security. Now, as we continue to put pressure on the southwest border, as we discussed a moment ago, I'm worried about squeezing the water border. What happens on the northern border? I toured our northern border. It is, for the most part, unprotected. Now, we have a wonderful relationship with Canada. I'm of Canadian descent. We have family members going back and forth. Lots of commerce. Our major trading partner is Quebec and Maritimes. But we need to make sure all of our borders are protected. Our ports, our seaports, our airports, and our physical borders. So with that, thank you, Ann. Those are the 5 or 6 things I'm going to stress today. Hopefully, we'll bring back to Washington. You'll be able to advocate for rural Maine and rural America, and we really appreciate you being here. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman. We appreciate those words. I didn't introduce myself. My name is Tim Hobbs. I'm the State Director for USDA Rural Development, and that's my role in helping facilitate what is going on here today. Just a little bit of background. Some people, when we talk about opioids in USDA and rural development, ask the question, and it's a logical question, why is USDA involved in this issue? What do you have to bring to the table? Why, you know, there's a lot of questions about our involvement, and seems odd to some people. So I hopefully can explain a little bit of that. Back in 2017, there were several reports and several pieces of information that came out. Center for Disease Control and Prevention published a report that said drug overdoses in rural America have surpassed drug overdose deaths in urban areas. in November of the same year, there was a survey done by the American Farm Bureau and the National Farmers Union that found over 74% of the farmers that responded had been directly impacted by opioid misuse. And that was in 2017 when that information became known. And this administration reacted to that and said, we've got a problem. We've got a problem in rural America, and we need to address it. Not that we have a lot of answers or any expertise in it, but we do have relationships with rural America through rural development. We've been around for a long time. We've had relationships with communities and a lot of the folks that are in this crisis and trying to manage it and trying to solve it. And so this current administration said that we would like USDA Rural Development to be the tip of the spear on addressing this issue. And so that's why we are here, and that's why USDA is involved. The Congressman mentioned that this is the fifth of five national roundtables, and we're proud to be able to participate at that level. These aren't the only roundtables that are taking place. These have spawned several others. In fact, I think New Hampshire is having one here in the next couple of days. That isn't an official roundtable as one of the original five, but this conversation is growing, and USDA is there, and we're glad to be a part of it and glad to be helping to create this opportunity for a conversation. The only other person that we haven't introduced is Ann Hazlett. She's the assistant to the Secretary for Rural Development, and she works out of Washington, D.C. We're glad to have her here with us. She has a passion about this issue, and you will hear that clearly in her presentation today. So she will be moderating the rest of the morning, and I will turn it over to her now. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you, Tim. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Tim, and to our team for hosting us today and for your leadership in building prosperity in rural Maine. I'm especially grateful, in addition to Tim, for being joined by Congressman Poliquin and Senator King. Both of you are strong and passionate voices for not only your state, but for rural America in Washington. We very much appreciate that voice. It is truly my honor to be here today and have a chance really to learn from each of you that are involved in our roundtable and those who are in the audience as well. So before I begin with some remarks about what we are doing at USDA, I just want to start by expressing my gratitude for your perspective and how much we value your partnership in addressing many issues in rural communities, particularly the opioid epidemic. You know, this crisis is a top priority for President Trump, for this administration, and at the Department of Agriculture, our core mission really is to help rural communities build prosperity. And so under that leadership of Secretary Perdue, the issue of opioid misuse is a high priority for our team. I think certainly while no corner of our country has gone untouched by this epidemic, we know that rural communities have been particularly hard hit. And you know that firsthand here in Maine, where I understand that drug deaths related to opioids have claimed the life of more than one Mainer each day. We think about the impact that this has in rural communities, whether we're talking about sharp declines in workforce productivity, to the overwhelming stress that I hear as I travel the country when you speak with local elected officials and the challenges that this places on them with the already limited resources that they have for social services, law enforcement, and economic attraction. This is deeply impacting the quality of life and economic opportunity in rural communities. So at USDA, as we think about how we can be really a strong partner to local leaders in addressing this epidemic, we understand that no two rural communities are the same, even within a state. And so that solution to this challenge really lies not in Washington, but at the community level. We know that a solution in the remote part of Oklahoma, for example, is going to look much different than it will in Maine or New Hampshire. So as we look at how we can best support local communities in this battle, the Department of Agriculture is really engaged on a number of fronts. First, we are equipping rural leaders on the front lines with tools to respond, with program investments in prevention, in treatment, and recovery. I think it's important, too, when we think about this issue, that these tools aren't just those immediate response needs, but it's also some of the infrastructure programs as well as business opportunities that we have the broadband programs, for example, that both of these members of Congress sitting to my left have been so active in fighting for, that access to high-speed internet. We know how important a tool that is to creating prosperity in these places that then creates resilience to a crisis like addiction. In addition to programs, we are really looking at how we can equip local leaders with information. One of the things that we did several months ago was to launch an opioids webpage on the USDA website. And we are using this really as a place that local leaders can find information not only about our own programs and how to apply, but also about the resources of some of our other agencies, our partner agencies, and nonprofit organizations. On that webpage, we recently launched an interactive map where visitors can connect to existing resources by state. We really built this as an empty library and are now filling it with books, if you will, as people send us information about what's going on in their communities. And we're looking at how we can help one community replicate what's working well in one place in another small town. Beyond information about existing resources, we are also actively developing tools that communities can use to do assessments as to better measure where they are against the perils of this issue. And lastly, we are focused on building strategic partnerships and facilitating the adoption of model practices. As noted in March, we kicked off a series of these rural roundtables conversations. These have really been designed to help us better understand the unique challenges that we have in rural communities in battling this issue, as well as learning about what's already working on the ground in rural America. We've held five, this is the fifth of these events. We've held events in Pennsylvania, in Utah, Kentucky, and Oklahoma. We're going to be using this information that we gather to better shape our own efforts and the activities of other rural partners that we work with so that we can all be more effective to local leaders on the ground. I think that the needs of the rural leaders that are brought up in these discussions are driving the development of new initiatives at the Department of Agriculture, areas such as transition housing, faith-based community responses, and workforce needs. I also believe that some of the needs that have been highlighted in these conversations have really driven a new level of coordination and leveraging of resources between USDA and some of our federal agency partners with resources for rural America, agencies like HHS and the Department of Justice. So with that, I will kick off our discussion as we are here really today to learn from each of you who are on the front lines of this battle and to see how we can better shape our resources as we partners to you in this fight. To maximize our time, I'd really like to focus our discussion on the three pieces of this issue, prevention, treatment, and recovery. But before we begin that discussion, I'd like to set the stage for our time together by calling on Courtney Allen to share a bit of her own story. Courtney.
Thank you. I want to start off just by thanking you for bringing me to the table. I get to be here today to represent the recovery movement that's happening in all of our communities, and I couldn't be more deeply honored to have that responsibility. As a caveat, though, I would like to start my story is just one of 23 million people's story across the nation that are recovering from substance use disorder. That's 23 million people across the country. We not only have an opiate epidemic, we have a recovery epidemic as well. And don't get me wrong, the opiate epidemic is real and very, very devastating. I work on the front lines every day. Fighting a war that none of us ever wanted. I have called a mother to tell her that her only son was dead, and I have held a child's hand as we lowered his father's body into the grave. I have watched a mother as she loses custody of her child, but I have also watched that same mother get her first job, her first house, her first car, and then I have watched her as she regained custody of that daughter. The epidemic has been horrific to watch, and yet the recovery epidemic is the most beautiful thing I've ever experienced. I'm a bit torn because we couldn't have one without the other, and it's kind of it's a conundrum, really. But today I'm here to share a little bit of my recovery story with you. My name is Courtney Allen, and I'm a person in long-term recovery, and for me that means today my children have a mother, and that my community has a member, and that my school has a scholar. I'm a 2016 graduate of Family Recovery Court in Kennebec County, and I'm chapter leader for Young People in Recovery for Augusta. I am also the founder of James's Place, the very first recovery housing in my community. My story, obviously, I wouldn't be in long-term recovery if my story was always perfect. I was born into a family infected with mental illness, poverty, substance use, and trauma. And honestly, it was just mostly pure chaos. I was 6 when I began caring for my mother's mental illness, and 7 when my parents divorced. 8 the first time I saw someone shooting up heroin, and it was also the first time I was put in protective custody myself. I was 9 when I began to realize that I wanted to help people that use drugs, and I was 10 when my dad was deployed to Afghanistan. I was 11 when my grandmother died from cancer, and she was the only person that was stable. At 12, someone began molesting me and my family, and by 13, I was using substances. There's a correlation there. And when I was 14, I dropped out of high school to have my first son. He was born on the day after Christmas in 2012, and he was the most perfect thing ever. I wanted so badly to be his mom. I wanted so badly to give him everything that I had never had in my life. And I did that for a long time for him. But by the time I was 19 and my second son was on the way, I was using drugs intravenously. And for a long time, I allowed the things that helped that had happened to me as a young girl define who I was as an adult. I don't blame my family because they never knew anything else. They were taught the things that they taught me, and it was passed on through generations and generations. What I've learned is that you get dealt the hand that you were dealt. And often it's not very fair. It is what we do with it that counts, really. And I'll get to what I've done with my hands, but I need to start at the moment that changed forever. Forever changed our lives. It's February 8th of 2015, and it's my 22nd birthday. My hands are shaking, and my body hurts so badly that I could barely walk the stairs to my children's room. I'm 30 pounds lighter than I am today, and I have track marks covering my arms. What I found in my children's room forever changed our lives. That morning, I saw the pain that I had experienced as a child reflecting in the eyes of them. And in that brief moment of clarity, I knew it was my fault. It wasn't my fault, but I knew that I had the power to change it. All in the course of 30 seconds, I went from caring only about how to make my pain go away to caring only about how to make theirs go away. That morning, I went to see detox. If I had been turned away from that detox bed, I wouldn't be sitting here with you today. And that's what often happens in my community. Almost every time I bring somebody to a detox, they're turned away. It's these moments in our stories that matter the most. In that detox, I was forced to sign my boys into protective custody, and there is no pain deeper than losing your children based on your own actions. It's a pain I've watched time and time again in parents who are affected with substance use disorder and aren't offered the opportunities that I have been. My opportunity came at long-term recovery, came from a family treatment court, one of the least likely places I ever thought I would get it. And there will never be enough words to fully credit those good and generous people that fought with me and for me in those courtrooms, in particular Judge Eric Walker and Trisha White, my case manager, Tiffany Penny, my nanny, and my anonymous people. Together, they forged a blend of compassion and acceptance with a bit of tough love to help me become, my shadow self become whole. And not only was I offered treatment and case management and wraparound services, I was offered a place that I never felt judged. It's pretty ironic in a courtroom. coming from a world that had treated me as if I was worthless and had told me that I would never amount to anything, in that courtroom, I was told that I was a person and that I could and would recover. And this simple fact was critical in my recovery. Even more so, just being exposed to people that were trying to find their way. Coming from my world, nobody was getting better, and mostly people were just dying. I had no idea that recovery was even possible. My anonymous people taught me that not only was recovery possible, it was inevitable if I was willing to work for it. And after 365 days of treatment, I was awarded full custody of those boys in a courtroom packed to capacity with family and friends by Judge Walker, the same judge who had helped save my life. It was amazing. Remember that pain I saw in their eyes the day I lost them? That was gone. And for the first time, I saw peace. I saw peace in their eyes, and I saw peace in mine. This will forever be my greatest accomplishment. And my life has changed dramatically since 3 years ago, since the day that I lost them. I faced good times, and I faced bad. I returned to school. I went from an eighth grade dropout to an honor roll student studying justice, mental health, and advocacy. I will use my degree to help create comprehensive legislation to fight the opioid epidemic as a public health issue and not a moral failing. And most recently, right now, my thing is LD925. It's a bipartisan funding package that is currently sitting on Governor LePage's desk as a veto. I call today if you have voting power to enact that. I have lost my significant other to a diabetic coma as a direct result of a resumption of use. And in the depths of acute grief, when I could not stand alone, my community again rose to stand with me. The moral of my story is that my community has been a pillar throughout my recovery, and I recognize that this is not the case for most people. I am very lucky. I am one of the lucky few who has received the treatment that I needed at the time that I needed it. And every day someone tells me that they can't find a detox bed, don't have insurance, or have nowhere safe to sleep tonight. These are the main reasons I am so passionate about building our communities up to become recovery ready. Communities that are recovery ready are ready to welcome someone into a recovery and create more stories like mine. I challenge you today to set aside all the undone things left on your desk, all the things happening in your personal lives, and even in your phones. Don't check your emails for the next 2 hours. But really, just listen to the experts today. They know what works and what does not. And then commit to implementing something into your community. Most recently, I've actually taken that challenge. On March 1st, I opened the doors to James's Place, the very first recovery residence in my community. It was founded by my partner, Dan, and I, but has been sustained completely by people in long-term recovery and recovery allies. And recovery allies are people that care for people in recovery. Our mission is to provide low-cost and low-barrier housing to people seeking recovery. Currently, right now, we house mostly drug court clients, but we want to expand. We are accomplishing our mission in the hardest hit areas in our town. And actually, right now, as we speak, our third recovery house is opening the doors for the first time to three people leaving Kennebec County Jail. The treatment program, CARA, releases today. If our doors weren't open, they would be housed in a rooming house in downtown Augusta that, I'll just say, it's not conducive for recovery. When I first started sobering up, all I ever wanted to do was pay back the people that had helped me. And what I found out was that I would never be able to pay them back for giving me a life. And even if I could, they're way too altruistic to accept my payback. So what I do today is instead pay it forward. And I have the distinct honor of doing that today. We all have a part to play in this opioid epidemic and the recovery epidemic, because each of us are affected by it. And whether it's small, whether it's as small as smiling at the person that's holding a sign on the side of the road, or as big as creating legislation, or anywhere in between. We know that for a fact that people can and do recover when given the opportunity to. Thank you.
Thank you.
thank you so much, Courtney, for your courage and your willingness to share your story with us and for your leadership. What a fitting way to start this discussion. I want to turn to the beginning with some thoughts about prevention. We need to know some of the root causes of opioid misuse, particularly in rural communities. We also need to know what is effective in keeping people from beginning to misuse these substances in the first place. Christine, I'd like to start with you. I think prevention often begins with leadership. And so from your role as a program leader at the Maine CDC, what have you seen as some of the key challenges in rural communities that are driving this issue in Maine? And then have you seen, worked with any rural communities where you've seen prevention activities that's been particularly impactful?
Absolutely, thank you. Thank you for having me, because I think prevention is such an important topic in this epidemic. I think when we're talking about the opiate crisis in the state of Maine, and I think about prevention and the work that we do in trying to reach youth and young adults before they start prevention of initiation of use, I think it's important to understand that most youth do not necessarily begin with injecting heroin. Most of the time, they're starting with other things such as alcohol, marijuana, tobacco, and yes, prescription drugs. So the work that we do in prevention is really not so much focused on the heroin piece, but more so focused on how do we get children and families to, preventing them from using those other substances. So I think that through the work that in the state of Maine, we have a structure called Maine Prevention Services, which is a collaborative of the Maine CDC as well as community partners to implement community level strategies. So there's five domains of Maine Prevention Services: substance use, tobacco use, youth engagement, obesity prevention, and mass reach health communications. So the work we do in substance use prevention across the state of Maine, our federal funding and some of our state funding actually covers the entire state of Maine, which is different than many other states. Most states use federal funding to target only specific communities, whereas we choose to put our funding out to all of the communities. So each First Substance Use Domain, University of New England, is the vendor, and they have subrecipients located across the entire state. Each of those subrecipients are implementing specific strategies in those communities based on community needs. So each of them are responsible for doing assessments of their community. They're looking at their Maine Integrated Youth Health Survey data. They're looking at, is alcohol more prominent than marijuana? Are prescription drugs more prominent? And they're implementing strategies based on what those community needs are. So what might happen in Aroostook County may look much different than what happens down in York County because of that flexibility of meeting those specific needs. So for instance, some of the different strategies that may be selected, it takes, for prevention, it's multiple strategies across multiple domains. What that means is that you have to target the individual, you have to target the parent, you have to target the community, you have to target schools, you have to make sure that interventions are happening across all of those domains. It's not just one message to one person that's going to impact change. So what we would do, for instance, we have a lot of programs related to underage drinking, because we know, again, that underage drinking in some of the more rural areas of Maine is more prominent. Kids who believe that they're there's no risk of harm, or if they don't think they're going to get caught, they're more likely to use. And so we do some targeted efforts in maybe those more rural areas to try to address some of those pieces. When it comes to specific to the opiate problem, we look more so at, again, the multiple strategies across multiple domains. So parents may be receiving education about safe storage and disposal. Children may be receiving a specific education program using the Prime for Life curriculum about substance use. At the same time, there would be a drug take-back event that's happening in that community where law enforcement and community providers are working together to take those prescription drugs out of the homes where youth could potentially access them. And then there's media campaigns that we've worked closely with other state agencies on to, again, get messages out there about how to find help, and also how to safely store medication, how to keep medication out of the hands of youth and young adults. And then on top of that, there's education programs that we have for prescribers regarding the opiate addiction, as well as some of the different pieces related to safe prescribing and all of that. And then also, we also promote the prescription monitoring program. So you've heard all of the list of things that are done, but again, that's multiple strategies across multiple domains. And the biggest, I guess the biggest piece of advice is that we cannot forget about the initiation of use, and that alcohol, marijuana, and tobacco are really where youth and young adults are starting to really get, that's what they're getting introduced to first, which can then lead to the bigger problems with using prescription drugs and heroin. So.
With respect in prevention, do you see, we've talked a bit about the difference between urban and rural communities, do you see any unique aspects of community life in a small, a small town versus a metropolitan area that impacts the most effective prevention?
I think that sometimes the smaller communities, there can be benefit because of the community relationships that are had. And again, when we go back to access and availability and perception of harm or perception of getting caught, those are the three risk factors for youth to be using substances as well. So if you have a local law enforcement who knows the adolescent in the community, and that adolescent may be less likely to host an underage drinking party, knowing that they know that local police department and they know that they're watching. So some of the, there are some strategies that can be had in the more rural communities, that that sense of community can be helpful, where people know each other and know that they may be caught, may reduce the risk of use. But at the same time, you know, there may be more opportunities for other substances to become more prominent, like methamphetamine and bath salts and other drugs, because of the rurality of the location. When you're looking at the larger communities, again, there's there may be more opportunity as well, because the relationships may not be there as they would be in the more rural parts of the state. I think when we're trying to get messaging out to across the state of Maine, whether it's through our mass reach health communications, our media, we still are continuing to develop things such as posters and brochures and rat cards, because we know that there are those places in the state of Maine that do not have internet access and don't have the availability to get our messaging through some of our digital pieces, like the others may.
Thank you. Leonard, I'd like to turn to you next with some thoughts. Christine's done a great job of laying out, particularly as how we can better reach youth. And I understand you have done some work looking at the adult population. Can you talk a bit about that work? Are there some key drivers that we see in the adult population? And do you see any trends there here in Maine or across the country that, that we should be aware of?
Anne, thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. My message regarding trends is an unfortunate one, and it's a simple reality that older adults are more likely than any other age group to experience and receive treatment for chronic pain. That treatment for chronic pain is made more complex because older adults are dealing with other medical needs at the same time, simultaneously. More than 80% of older adults between the ages of 57 and 85 take at least one prescription medication. And 50% of older adults take five or more medications and supplements daily. We call that polypharmacy, and we know that it leads to significant difficulties and issues in terms of medication management. Complicating matters is the expectation that the baby boomers, you know who you are, you were born between 1946 and 1964, and you're turning 65 at the rate of 10,000 a day across this nation. They turn 65 at the rate of 50 a day here in the state of Maine. And these are individuals that are expected to misuse not only psychoactive medications, but alcohol, more so than any previous age group. Higher proportions of older adults, as we've heard, reside in rural communities than urban and suburban settings, and like their young rural neighbors, have a long history of physically demanding jobs. Those physically demanding jobs are accompanied by chronic pain in frequent cases. These are the very individuals, in fact, who are at highest risk of adverse drug events and will benefit most from more informed personal care practices. Adherence to medication regimes is essential to ensuring optimal patient outcomes, but there are two barriers, especially for older adults, that create problems in terms of medication compliance, and those are miscommunication and misunderstanding. Unfortunately, surveys confirm that there is a communication gap, a strong one, a powerful one, between older patients and their healthcare providers around prescription medications in particular. Namely, over 40% of older Americans do not follow the medication regimens that are prescribed. This non-adherence grows with increases in chronic conditions. And about one-third of older adults do not even discuss their non-adherence with their healthcare providers. Further contributing to the potential communication gap between healthcare providers and older adults receiving pain medication are the effects that long-term opioid use can have on an individual's what's called episodic foresight. Episodic foresight refers to the mind's ability to travel forward in time and analyze, project, and address outcomes and situations that they're likely to face. Long-term opioid use has been shown to cause deficits in the mind's ability to do just that, to project into the future. Decline in episodic foresight can be a particularly difficult condition to detect in older adults because it can mimic the aging experience, even the normal aging experience. To summarize then, older adults are particularly susceptible to adverse drug events because their medication regimens include more medications than other age groups. Elders may know their medications and what they take them for, but what they don't know are the possible interactions and side effects that those medications may have. Compounding this are the documented health disparities and problematic health communication experiences that older adults have with their healthcare providers. For example, older patients are more likely to unquestionably trust a doctor's recommendation for taking medication. And doctors, in turn, not in all cases, but in some cases, may display non-supportive communication behaviors, such as inattentive listening, or addressing a younger person who may be in the presence of that older adult, him or herself. It is critical that older adults be empowered to better understand and communicate their needs and exchanges with their healthcare providers. It's particularly important, I think, that older adults be able to communicate openly and honestly with their healthcare providers. Ultimately, it's effective communication with a provider that plays a vital role in a patient's ability, an older patient's ability, to safely adhere to a prescribed course of medication. Thank you.
Thank you, Leonard. Courtney, I want to take a minute and turn back to you. As somebody that is standing in victory over addiction, when you look back at your life, are there certain things you think could have made a difference for you from a prevention standpoint in your own story?
Absolutely. I've thought about this many times. Based on my trauma as a child, if there had been trauma prevention or trauma, just trauma treatment for children, that's another epidemic happening in our communities and one that I'm still working on to face within my own children.
Thank you. Before I open it up for anyone else's comments on prevention, I do want to turn first to Congressman Paul Quinn. I understand that you recently founded a bipartisan rural hospital caucus, and I know that this caucus has several areas of focus: telehealth, supporting the veterans that have already been mentioned, as well as combating the opioid epidemic. Knowing that this effort has just begun, Do you see how any of those focuses could be effective in this area of prevention?
Yeah, I think getting the message down to Washington, which is one of the reasons that I formed the caucus, it was to make sure I stay very well informed about the issues that affect our rural hospitals, but also make sure we're very clear with folks down at DC that these rural hospitals are struggling to stay open. We need to make sure that they're given the flexibility they need when it comes to regulations. We need to make sure they get paid by the VA for treating veterans closer to their homes in issues of telehealth and telemedicine.
I heard over the weekend some of the hospitals are being paid 180 days in arrears by the VA.
There are some hospitals, actually, I appreciate bringing that up, there are some hospitals that have been paid in 1 to 2 years. And my hair caught on fire when I found this out, and that was one of the
And these are struggling hospitals that don't have a lot of
that's correct.
Ability,
margin.
Right.
Yeah, that's correct.
That's so, a simple thing of just the VA right. paying the bills.
Well, it's also the fact that we have at the VA 385,000 employees and 100 different computer systems that don't talk with each other, and so they can't determine who's getting paid for what and at what time. So we're now fixing that. There are a lot of problems in the VA, but we're getting there. And this is one of them. I really appreciate you asking that, Ian. Thank you. Thank you, Lance.
Senator King, I want to turn to you for a minute on this issue of prevention because you've been a leader in this area, and you mentioned your particular passion for that in your opening remarks. I understand that you're particularly interested in drug take-back and making it easier to get rid of some of these medications in our communities. Can you talk a bit about what you see could be most effective in this area, particularly in a rural setting?
Well, I think Courtney really put a finger on it, that there's an intimate relationship between drug addiction and mental health. And to be honest, we're not addressing the mental health issue sufficiently. I had dinner with two colleagues just a couple of weeks ago, and we were talking about this issue. It turns out that NIH, which does research into physical illnesses, gets about $37 billion a year of funding. NIMH, which is the National Institute of Mental Health, that does research into mental health, gets about $1.5 billion. That's a ratio of about 35 to 1 of money that I think we've got to deal with that. Because if you do, I've seen charts for NIH where the more money goes into research, the death rate goes down. It works. And 35 to 1 is ridiculous when you consider the relationship of mental health issues to addiction. I think in terms of prevention, that's a long-term issue, but it's one that we have to begin to address, it seems to me. Just making notes as we've heard, first, Courtney, your statement was stunning, and I think one of the most important things, Courtney, is that you're here. There's a perception that there's no such thing as recovery. Mm-hmm. That if you're involved in this terrible scourge, you're dead, and you can't recover. And the fact that people like yourself, and I know them all across Maine, are leading productive lives, contributing to their communities, is an important part of getting this dealt with. Reducing the stigma so that people will go for help. And one of the points you made that I think was, you said, if the detox beds hadn't been available the day you went, you probably wouldn't be here. And to me, the greatest tragedy, and from talking to people both in addiction and in recovery, is if somebody's ready to say, I need help, which is a huge step, and to have the help, have somebody then say, well, it'll be a 3-month wait, is often a death sentence. And that's where I think you guys can help us with the infrastructure, with facilities, with mobile clinics, with whatever. You can help us with the bricks and mortar, and then we can develop the treatment models. But I'm straying from prevention. But I think in prevention, we've got to be, I want to know what works. And again, Anne, something you said that I think is so important is, if something's working in St. Louis or San Francisco or Peoria, let's replicate it. Let's not have every community have to reinvent it. Let's find out what works in one town or another. I'm very excited about this model of hub and spoke treatment that they're pioneering in Ellsworth, Maine. where there's no central treatment facility, but there's a place where people can go, but then they've got 30 local primary care physicians who are trained to provide treatment. And so you don't have to go to a big institution, but your local doc can help. That may be a model for rural America that I think could be very promising. But again, to go back, I'm convinced, and there's a small group of us, and hope there'll be more of us, that we've got to start putting more funds into mental health, not only treatment, but research, so that we can make treatment more effective. Trauma is part of mental health, and how to deal with it. So those are some of the thoughts that I've had from this excellent discussion so far. Thank you.
Thank you. Sheriff Morton and Mr. Brickell, I would like to turn to you both as community leaders and just get your thoughts in prevention, what you've seen, the importance of community engagement in addressing this issue as it comes into a community and before it takes hold. Any lessons learned there, either from your own communities or the communities in which you work with your peers?
Well, first of all, we want to thank you for coming to Penobscot County. Welcome all of you to Penobscot County. We are a rural county. We have 67 towns covering 3,900 square miles. With lights and sirens, it takes me 2 hours to get from one end of the county to the other. So we are rural. Law enforcement, I think, has made, of the three things here, prevention, law enforcement, recovery, I think law enforcement has made one of the biggest changes. Going from a thought process of that we had to sanction our way out of a problem. I think that's how we started many years ago. Law enforcement has engaged today closer with our recovery communities than we ever had before. I remember somebody at a recent meeting that we had said, law enforcement used to hate us, now they love us. And so I think that's a positive thing, that we're working together on these three issues. Things like training for law enforcement has changed. The fact that law enforcement today carries Narcan. The fact that we're involved in our prescription drug takebacks. With that being said, Maine continues to rank number one per capita the amount of prescription medications taken back every single year that this has been run nationwide. It continues to be an issue. But that is the engagement that we're having with our community. Very interestingly, according to the initial comments were so powerful to me. We have the only jail in Penobscot County, and I find myself walking in and meeting with folks that are incarcerated, and it's not about today, where did you get your drugs? We have enforcement folks to do that. Today it's about how do folks end up here? And so I've done my unscientific study of our populations, and what I constantly hear is that it was started because of trauma in their lives, and that we haven't taken care of it. Perhaps early we start with help in trauma or childhood trauma, but not continuing throughout their lives. We also see that it was poor pain management, and I think that we've made great progress in dealing with our doctors and dealing with our pharmacies and making progress there. The other part is those that are in recovery, that are in the jail. We often hear from them, well, they talk about, I was able to be in recovery for a year or 6 months, and so we really need to find out, why did that work? The sad thing that I heard over and over was, it started by being in jail and detoxing. Most of you have heard me say that we are the largest detoxification center, largest mental health facility in the state, and it shouldn't be that way.
Without the resources.
But today we're sitting worried about the veto of county jail funding. I know that's a state-level issue, but when by default we become these resources to folks. Law enforcement today, we're asking law enforcement officials to divert folks that are in crisis. But where do we divert them to? There are very few detoxification centers, particularly in rural areas, where somebody in crisis can simply be taken by law enforcement or themselves and show up and have a bed. We all know that funding is an issue, insurance is an issue for us. So often they end up in the hospitals, or they find themselves in such crisis that criminal charges are now in place. And it only complicates the problem. So today, I'm here to tell you that law enforcement wants to stand side by side with those in the recovery world, particularly, as Senator King said, in prevention. We see how difficult the law enforcement part is and how difficult recovery can be, but the one area that we can make a difference, I think, is prevention. So we hope that we can stand side by side and continue to do those efforts. And one last piece I have to add onto this, because I think this is so crucial when we're talking about ruralness. Even if we have great programs in place, whether it's our faith community, which I personally feel is one of the strongest areas we can make a difference, but all the other great programming we have to make sure that people's basic needs are taken care of. If we provide them with treatment in rural areas or in our urban areas, they still have to have housing, transportation, food, education, jobs. I hope that all of you see that when law enforcement speaks about this today, it shows you that our mindset is much different about tackling the problem that has affected all of us. We know there is no discrimination when it comes to the opioid crisis. Urban or rural, small town, big towns, rich or poor, education or less education, it's wiping out all of our friends and our families.
Thank you for your comments. I mentioned partnerships, I guess, in my opening remarks, and one of the things we've been doing at the department is monthly to bring together a group of rural organizations that have an interest in rural communities around this issue. It's amazing just how getting people talking sometimes, we're all so busy wanting to do something and getting people talking about what they're doing can really leverage each other's activities, and the Sheriff's Association has recently joined that conversation. So know that y'all are deeply engaged in this, both at a community and at that national level. So thank you.
Jules had some great, Joyce has some great success with the patrol. Do you mind mentioning?
Yeah.
So we're fortunate, and that is part of federal funding that comes into the state of Maine with a program that we have, and Dr. Gardner may speak of this too, which has been wonderful to us. We have a program in the jail called RISE, and it's based on medical-assisted treatment with the use of a medicine called Vivitrol. And whether you're a supporter of Vivitrol or any of the other medical-assisted treatments, one of the most important things that we see in this program is the group and individual counseling that takes place in the jail. Again, on my unofficial scientific study of speaking with folks in the jail is, we may be able to provide a program in the jail, set them up with some success, only to open the door and push them out, and then figure out on your own.
Into the same environment.
And so what this program does is it tackles the ongoing treatment outside, and it's funded. It has to be funded. And so people that are engaged in the program inside the jail are released. Up to a year later, they can engage with the same providers. Telling your story over and over to different providers can be a challenge itself. And this allows for that to happen. And we're really excited that when we started the program, the housing authority came to us, transportation came to us, because we know that in order for somebody to be successful, those basic needs have to be met.
Is it true that if you're qualified for Medicaid, the moment you cross into the jail, that stops?
That's true. It continues to be a serious challenge. It's one of the issues that we hear both from the state and federal level is, why is the county jail's medical bills so expensive? Have to think about this, that when folks come in and their insurances are taken away from us, we're like the ER. We are a crisis response to somebody who's in immediate crisis. And so sometimes our medical costs are higher.
Thank you. Mr. McKell, do you have anything to add really from that community perspective?
I can kind of echo a lot of what Sheriff Morton says. Mm-hmm. Because not only am I the town manager model, but also the police chief. So I get to see a lot of the interactions that we have on different levels with the public, whether it be the summer meals programs that we do with kids, which is a big thing. And I think that a lot of, since we're talking about prevention, I think a lot of the common denominator that we're seeing here is, when it comes to addiction and to this opioid crisis, is there's a lack of connection with people. And it's all starting with when, listen to what Courtney had to say when she was younger and the traumas that she went through, and I really congratulate you. And I think that what you went through is just it's just amazing that you made it here this far. I'm very happy to hear that. Your story echoes kind of where I began with my journey with trying to get involved with the opioid crisis, because I had a young lady in town that I was trying to help out. She was in a relationship. She just had a child. There was always domestics going on. And before I was the town manager, I was just a cop in town. I was dealing with domestics every day with them. It was, least 3 times a week, I'd be going to their house, and I'd be like, another rat again. And it was usually, let me put the guy in the cruiser, and we'll go take a ride, and he'll cool off, or let me take him in the car, and we'll go and get some diapers for the baby, or we'll support him for the baby. And as it went on, and she fell deeper and deeper into her addiction, I had to take the kid away. I had to start that process, because it just got to that point. And she wound up going into recovery and became very much of an advocate for recovery. And unfortunately, about a week before she was supposed to get a kid back, she met up with some old friends and, hey, let's just do one for the road. And she did one for the road, and that was the last one she did because she passed away. And I still see her kid every day. I'll still see him in school. And that's another thing, too, is connections. We talk about prevention. I'm usually in the school with the kids every day, whether it be the elementary school, the high school. But I see her son every day, and I talk with him, and I see him at some meals programs that we're doing in Milo 3 days a week to help with these kids. Because Milo is a town of, it's a small town. It is rural Maine right there. It's a blueprint. It's a picture of what rural Maine is. Less than 2,300 people. We have 620 kids enrolled in the school system. 92% of them are considered food insecure. They qualify for free and discounted meals. So we make sure that when the schools are out, that the kids are getting fed, and that's a big deal for me. And that keeps the connections going. That keeps relationships going with kids, positive connections, because I think that where a lot of these issues are coming from are that people are not having the connections with the people that matter in their lives, and they're not having the right connections. They're having destructive connections, and I think that by fostering a positive area for those folks, that we can do that. We've tried that also with our older communities, our older citizens, through AARP and our age friend communities, because I do find that we do have a large older community. And in that older community, we have people that I've actually worked several cases with, older people who have sold their prescriptions because they worried about where was I going to buy my meds, where was I going to get my meal from, how was I going to pay for my fuel, how was I going to pay for my electric bill. They knew an app, the easy way to do it was to sell prescription pills. And that's where a lot of, like I said, I had several cases with elderly that were selling them. So we're trying to make these connections with people and to keep the sense of community together. And we're doing those in different ways. But it falls back down on funding, and it falls back on, there's a lot of apathy in a lot of small towns. People just, they're just blah, they're just set in their ways with how their town goes. And I don't sound like I'm from here. I'm from New York. I did 20 years in the New York City Police Department before I came here. And before I did a lot of work with drugs and homicides and things of that nature. So I kind of saw when I came to Maine, I saw that this was I hate to use the word target-rich environment, but this is a state where a drug dealer is going to want to come. The state of Maine has less than 3,000 police officers, pretty much, covering this area. New York City Police Department has over 35,000 police officers covering just New York City. So there was always somebody on the beat, and there was always somebody working. And here in Maine, especially in the rural areas, if you look at just Piscataquis County, you have the sheriff's office, which is in Dover, and anything east of Dover, it's Milo. There's several towns, but Milo is the only police department that's visible on that side of the county. So what I try and do is to combine my roles, my town manager role and my police chief role. And we use social media a lot, and I use my Milo police page to kind of get attention here and there. And I know I've made connections with Senator King and with Congressman Poliquin, and I've been very appreciative of everything they've done. And Bruce's story touches me greatly, and I feel that. And Senator King has been very involved with our programs that we've tried to do in town with, we call it Operation Hope. It's the heroin opioid prevention effort. It's modeled after what goes on in other New England states, in Massachusetts and New Hampshire, where people can come and turn their drugs in. We won't prosecute them, but we'll find the help. And the problem is finding the help and getting to where they need to be. We don't have the resources in small town Milo, Maine. We don't have the resources in Piscataquis County. We just don't. So what we try and do is keep those connections going and keep those positive reinforcements, especially with the kids. Because if you start them when they're young, they're going to understand the negative impact that these things have, and to help these kids to become the leaders that they are, whether it be Prime for Life that we're doing in the high school. Those things just give kids, give younger adults a sense of purpose and a sense of leadership. And that's what people need. And that's what people need to feel, is they need to feel important. I think that's pretty much where my head's at with this whole thing. I really appreciate being a part of this. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much. I connect with so much of what you've shared today. And I think in my own experience working on this issue, both the Department of Agriculture as well as volunteer ministry, what I see oftentimes is communities that have been through this come out stronger, because it does highlight some of the breakdown that we have in community, even in rural places, that becomes the beginning of this darkness. And I find that to be a very bright glimmer of hope in all of this. With that, I want to keep our conversation moving, so I'd like to move on to treatment. I think we've already heard a great deal about the need for access to treatment, and we know this is critical in any community, but particularly in rural areas. There's some daunting statistics out there that suggest that more than 80% of rural Americans live in a county that do not have any access to treatment services. So with that reality, I think as already has been mentioned, in many rural communities, jail facilities become default treatment, which is not effective or sustainable. Chris, I would like to begin with you, really from a macro perspective, looking at this issue. Working for the Health Resources and Services Administration, an agency within HHS, is a core partner to us at USDA, and we have really begun to work more closely with some of your leadership on this issue as we look at how we can leverage funds that are out there for rural America, as well as staff and infrastructure that we have at Rural Development, to help make some of these connections. What are some of the key treatment-related challenges that you see in rural Maine? And can you talk a bit at all about any of the programs or initiatives that HRSA is working on right now to help look at this issue?
Sure. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me. And yeah, I think if there's any upside to this crisis that we're experiencing right now, is that HHS, I think, is doing a much better job of working together with certainly HRSA, working with someone like USDA, those organizations. I think we've really expanded our scope considerably in trying to deal with this. I want to especially thank Courtney for your story, because every time I hear a story like yours, it sort of reminds me of all the things that we're trying to do at a federal level, at an HHS level, to address this issue. And there were several things that came up, and I just jotted down some notes that I think are really important for us to all keep in mind as we move forward on this. And I will address your question in terms of what HRSA is doing, but I just wanted to say some of the things that came to my mind was access to care, which you just identified. HRSA's been working on that. Trauma-informed care at a young age. HRSA has school-based health centers that we are trying to implement more trauma-informed care at a young age for those individuals affected by any sort of trauma, because it doesn't have to be necessarily drug-related to be more susceptible to opioid use disorder or any other substance use disorder at a later time. Detoxification bed availability. We can do a lot of things at an outpatient level through medication-assisted treatment with full behavioral health supports. But if we do not have the immediate needs of individuals at the time of crisis, like the detoxification beds, that's another issue that we really need to continue to address as a team. Wraparound services, we talked about the importance of having jobs, having assistance for families, having meaning in your life, having housing and healthy housing. We did an event in Portland, Maine last year, very similar to this, that Hirsa, who is a partner with the Greater Portland Community Health Center, one of our grantees there. And the amount of homeless people there is very, very high. And the shelters that have that were housing most of the patients for the health center were really not healthy places for people to try to recover. Just a lot of use going on in the shelters, and very, very difficult to recover when you're in that sort of in those sorts of conditions. And then treatment for mothers. HRSA has a bureau called Maternal Child Health, and we're doing a lot of work with trying to get treatment specific for opioid use disorder with mothers and families, because that is a unique situation where you have children who are relying on you that need to be taken care of while you're getting your treatment. And then we talked a little bit about corrections as well. That's usually where people end up, is in corrections to start out, and so we need to have better systems of managing those patients and making sure that they get the outpatient care that they need. So with all that said, I just wanted to address some of the things that I think are so important in these events, to hear a story. Because when you hear the story, you realize all of the things that someone experiences and what we need to do together collectively, do a better job of moving forward. With that said, I represent HRSA, which is Health Resources Services Administration. We're a grant-giving organization that provides federal money to grant money primarily to community health centers, federally qualified community health centers. But I'm just one small piece of HHS, which there are so many things happening in HHS right now, and we're working collaboratively. I need to at least mention the Substance Abuse Mental Health Services Administration. And Kathy Power was here today. She's actually the regional administrator for SAMHSA. They are the lead agency still with the federal government when it comes to substance abuse and mental health services. However, HRSA, which is traditionally a primary care organization, we fund organizations that provide primary care. Over the last decade, fortunately for me, because it happens to be an area of my interest, primary care has really been redefined. And primary care now consists of things like a full array of mental health services, including substance use disorder treatment. And so HRSA has been funding, specifically extra funding, in addition to the base funding for community health centers, to provide a full range of mental health and substance abuse services. The most important thing I want to express to you today is that here in Maine, you have 20 community health centers. 70 access sites of those 20 community health centers, they often have branches that provide access to care. Regardless of ability to pay, those organizations need to provide a full range of primary care, including mental health and substance abuse services. If they don't have it at that particular site, they will refer you to somebody who does. But many of them now have their own services for both mental health and substance use disorder treatment. HRSA has continually funded both substance use and mental health services over the last 10 years, and most recently, the acronym is called AIMS. We have a lot of acronyms in the federal government. This is Access Increases in Mental Health Services. And these funds are going specifically to these community health centers, the 20 here in Maine. Some of the 20 here in Maine are receiving this extra funding for both mental health and substance use services. So those are some of the things that we are doing. We have a lot of bureaus and bureaus within HRSA that specifically focus on certain challenges in public health, including the Office of Rural Health Policy and the Office of Information Technology. And the reason I bring those two up is because one of the things I think is really critical is access to care, and we need to get more creative, especially in more rural populations like this, and develop more enhanced programs with regard to telehealth services. We have something in the Northeast that HRSA helps to fund. It's called the Northeast Telehealth Resource Center. And they do a fantastic job of finding the best practices out there as it relates to telehealth and providing primary care, mental health, and substance use services to individuals in remote areas so that we can, and there's a bunch of different models that can be utilized when it comes to that, and how we can actually treat patients at the ground level. But we need to continue to do better work with that as it relates to the rural population. There's a lot more I could talk about as it relates to HRSA, but I realize that we're limited on time here. But I do want to also say that there's going to be a federal breakout panel this afternoon with some of my colleagues who will also be speaking about some of their programs as well.
Well, thank you, Chris. And again, we appreciate the strong partnership with your agency. Dr. Gardner, I want to turn to you for that local community health center perspective. In addition, I think we've had already a fair amount of discussion about the impact on children. And I think about how the statement is often made that addiction is a family disease, and often that is referring to it doesn't just impact the person that's struggling with that disease, but it impacts much of the family around them. So, can you talk a bit about what the services you offer at Penobscot Community Health Center and how that might differ from a traditional treatment model?
Sure, thank you, Anne, very much. I'm honored to share this experience with this distinguished panel, roundtable members, but especially with Ms. Allen, someone of that incredible strength. So thank you for being here, and thank you for sharing with us. My name is Trip Gardner. I'm a physician specializing in psychiatry. I've been employed by Penobscot Community Health here, which is a federally qualified health center, as Captain Bersani mentioned, for the last 14 years, where I'm fortunate to serve as the Chief Psychiatric Officer and the Medical Director of Homeless Health Services. I have encountered chronic brain diseases over the last 25 years many times, including addiction and opioid use disorder as part of that. At PCHC, we have five medication-assisted recovery opioid use disorder programs. And what's unique about what we do is that we seek to integrate the treatment of the addiction with the whole person. So we offer that person primary health care, individual counseling, group counseling, case management, psychiatric medication management, all in the same location with coordinated teams that work seamlessly together to treat the whole person. This year, already we have treated 400 unique individuals, and this number grows every single day. And it's not enough. We're not doing enough. We should be doing the same thing at any community health center, utilizing things like telemedicine, as Captain Bersani mentions, for those that are smaller, but there should be no way not to do this at a community health center. It should be like a community health center saying we don't treat hypertension. The response should be the same. In addition to the effect on the individual, addiction has a heavy impact on the family and the communities who struggle with understanding the symptoms of this illness as those from a real disease that takes their loved one. Addiction affects the brain, which is the organ of our bodies responsible for connecting us to the community, making the connections that Chief Pickle talked about. That organ, when diseased, affects everyone. Like dominoes falling or like a stone rippling in a pond. I think that our lack of understanding of addiction as a real disease is the most critical problem and is the way that we can break this epidemic. And I'm talking about all of us. I don't think all of us really think it's a disease in the same way as hypertension or diabetes or the Ebola virus. Do we see that same response to this epidemic as you saw with the Ebola virus? I think not. Particularly people in the healthcare field. We are not acting like it's an epidemic. So understanding opioid use disorder is critical. Addiction is a disease of brain circuits that affect emotion, motivation, memory, and reward. These lead to biological, psychological, social, and spiritual symptoms. Symptoms like turning the kind into the unkind, and the honest into the dishonest, the caring into the selfish, the unreliable into the reliable, or the reliable into the unreliable.
So much for a lie for me, huh? It's these lies, they're so hard. Not used to the big stage. The cause of this disease, our high-level human brain controls give way to our misplaced primitive deep survival-level drives for reward and relief. These are the same drives that all animals have. The same ones that would lead us to take almost any risk or do almost anything if we were dying of thirst. The same drives to survive that would cause us to lose our self-control and fight each other to get out of here if the oxygen in this room ran out. Addicted individuals have an inability to consistently use their thoughts and beliefs to apply the top-down brake that protects us from the pursuit of unhealthy pleasure, as if that brake line is cut. This means that people with addiction may very well know the danger of using and truly not want to use. They hit the brake, but it does not work. And the survival drive keeps going forward toward the substance erroneously. The primitive brain interprets, well, if she's not stopping me, it must be necessary for me to survive. And the powerful, learned automatic drive that is the same for food and water kicks in. This disconnection between the thinking brain and the reward brain separates those with this illness from their career, their loved ones, their values, their personality. They go deeper and deeper into themselves, and without treatment, they die. Just like other chronic diseases. The good news is that those who accept responsibility for managing this chronic disease are able to reconnect the brake line, allowing them to be successful in recovery. Treatment outcomes for this disease are as good as treatment outcomes for other chronic diseases, like diabetes, like hypertension. In fact, more people relapse with hypertension treatment than with addiction treatment. In fact, some data on individuals who are in long-term recovery speak to the fact that people with addiction who are in long-term recovery do better, more successful than the rest of us. It is important to understand those factors that put us at risk so we can look to decrease these risks in ourselves and our communities. We've heard a lot about that here today. I would second everything everyone else has said. Addiction is influenced equally by biological factors like genetics, time of first use, and environmental factors, mostly the most of which would be the adverse childhood experiences that people experience. Perhaps the first one people experience is a lack of attachment as a baby, that we have to address healthy planning, and we have to address wrapping surfaces around the mom, not just when she's pregnant, but afterwards, so that we can limit the damage done by not allowing attachment. Also policies that lead us to marginalize people away from society in an effort to try and help, in an effort that says, if we just make it so bad, surely they'll not use, have failed. They may not have been done out of a lack of compassion, but we need to be smart and recognize that the criminalization and the losing employment and losing your chance at removing employment for the rest of your life, that's failed us. That's not worked. Wish it did, but it did not. We have to speak out and recognize this. We have to work to prevent the modifiable risk factors and change the public health model that integrates people together. All of this speaks to what Congressman Polakum brought up earlier when he said that if you had addiction in a small town, you might be embarrassed. He's right. And your family might be ashamed. And he's right. And you might want to have a directory so you could go out of state so no one would even know what was happening to you. Now, what if you had diabetes or cancer or hypertension or asthma? Would any of that apply? No. And we all understood what Congressman Bolton said. I'm a doctor. I understood exactly what he said. I'm sure I might be embarrassed myself. We have to recognize this is a real disease, and we have to treat it like a real disease. And when we do, everything else will fall into place. One last thing, we also have to recognize the incredible risk that people with opioid use disorder are under. When you look at something like carfentanil, a fentanyl analog, which is much more powerful than fentanyl, which is much more powerful than anything else, getting added to the things people are injecting, realize that 80 milligrams of this would kill 4,000 people. And how much is 80 milligrams? I looked at a pack of Sweet Mo before I came in here. Guess how much? How much is in a pack of sweetened wood? 1 gram. So 80 milligrams is not even a whole pack of sweetened wood. Would kill 4,000 people. So we need to have more compassion for people with this addiction and realize the incredible risk they're undertaking in our community and do everything everyone's talked about to fix this. And we need to do it now. These are not new things people are mentioning. We're just not doing it.
Thank you, Dr. Gardner. Stephanie, I want to turn to you really to continue with this focus on the disease and the role that you play in the medical community, really helping train up that next generation of pharmacists. Can you talk a bit about the role that you see the pharmacy community playing in this battle? I know that in my travels, I've heard a great deal about the prevention role that pharmacists can often play because they are, especially in a rural community, they're on the front lines. They can tell you what's going on a lot of times in people's homes, the stresses that people might be under. What's your perspective? And specifically, I understand there's a provider collaboration task force. You could talk a bit about that as well.
Sure. Yeah, I'd be happy to. And good morning, everyone. And I echo all the thoughts here. Thank you so much for doing this, for coming here, and for inviting me. I'm really excited to share some of my thoughts. So I think one of the first things that pharmacists, or one of the more recent things that pharmacists can bring to the table right now here in Maine, is we can now prescribe naloxone, which is huge. That has been in effect since May 24th, I believe. And so at this point, patients can go to any pharmacy in the state and ask for a licensed pharmacist who's completed the naloxone CE, the 2-hour CE, to prescribe naloxone to them. If it's not a pharmacist who has naloxone prescribing, there is a standing order through Hannaford's through Dr. Noah Nesson as well. So pharmacists can do it through a collaborative standing order as well. So that's one of the first things I think that is really encouraging that we can do here in this state, and that's also something that is occurring throughout the country, pharmacists prescribing naloxone. I think the second huge role that pharmacists have, and it goes all the way down even to students, right, is education, as you were discussing. And so we have three sort of people that we educate. We educate our fellow students and each other, we educate patients, and we educate the provider community. And so from a student education perspective, one of the things that we've done in the past several years in response to this is dramatically increase the amount of education that students receive around pain management, non-pharmacy pain modalities, around substance use disorders, and even around stigma and language. So the students now get an hour, all students in our pharmacy school get an hour around stigma and around appropriate language to use when discussing substance use disorders. Because as we know, language is huge and it can create a barrier before you even really get going. From a patient education perspective, I think there are a lot of things the pharmacists can offer and are doing right now. Earlier we were discussing large numbers of patients who are not adherent to medications, which is quite concerning, and I'll share an even worse statistic with you. If you look at being refilled on time, that number drops to about 15% of patients take their medications and refill them on time and appropriately. So that's another area where pharmacists can really help with, is increasing patient adherence to medication. We're also highly trained at assessing drug-drug interactions, assessing adverse effects, and really helping patients to understand the appropriate use of multiple medications in settings of polypharmacy. We also can discuss, as I mentioned, alternatives with patients, including over-the-counter alternatives to treat pain. Sometimes simple switches in medications can really spare opioid doses, as well as other drugs that can be added to the regimen to make it more risky, such as benzodiazepines, avoiding those by using alternatives. From a provider education perspective, pharmacists are doing many things in the state and nationally. We are providing didactic education to providers. So we do this to students We do it at Maine Medical Center. We're actually starting a substance use disorder didactic lecture series for the tough students that come through. We do education to the residents, and we also even do attending education as well. So I've presented to the American College of Physicians meeting before as well to discuss opioids. We educate in experiential fashion, so while residents and students are on rotations in a real-time thing, in a real-time basis, they can call us with consults and we can help educate them about appropriate management, again, of pain, of substance use disorders, and then very commonly the question comes up, how do we deal with pain in the context of substance use disorders? We attend and participate and offer journal clubs regarding substance use disorders, as well as case conferences. And then another interesting thing that we do in the state, and I know that they do it in New Mexico and other states, is Project Echo, which is sort of a train-the-trainer program. So I'm a pharmacist on some of these groups. There are a group of different experts that come to the table and meet to train experts, you know, via webinar. So it's all electronic meeting via webinars, meet to train experts throughout the state who can then train the people that they work with. So it's sort of a hub and spoke model. We have echoes going right now for compassionate tapering of opioids and benzos. We have an echo around perinatal opioid use disorders, and then there's going to be an echo starting on medication-assisted therapy. And those are three main quality counts. We also help with academic detailing, so I'm part of the advisory group that helps with main academic detailing, then it goes out and educates other providers. I don't do the detailing myself, but I help advise that team. And then the last thing is what you mentioned earlier, which is the Maine Pharmacist Provider Task Force that we started last summer, so it's been about a year now. We meet now every other month. We originally met once monthly. It's a task force that I chair, and we have a group of really great clinicians, both pharmacists and providers and other interested parties that come to the table, the electronic table. Again, it's a big state, so it's a virtual meetings. And we discuss challenges largely around collaboration and communication between pharmacists and providers, and largely originally around Chapter 488, which is the legislation we have here in Maine around the opioid epidemic. So when that first went live, there were some issues and things that sort of needed to be hammered out, and there weren't as many venues for pharmacists and providers to collaborate directly. And so we started this task force. We got pharmacists and providers to the table. We have members from all the different state organizations. We have representative from Senator King's office as well, Edie Smith. Shout out to her, I know she's in the audience someplace. And so it's been great. It's just been great to really connect, talk about what's going on, talk about opportunities, and really collaborate.
Thank you, and thank you for your leadership. Want to take a minute to look at treatment through the lens of law enforcement and the judicial system. Let me start, I guess, Sheriff Morton, with circling back to you. There was some discussion about the successful project you have going with Vivitrol. Can you talk just a little more detail about how did that program come about? What are some of the challenges and opportunity there, and can it be replicated in other counties?
I think it can be replicated. It started with a meeting with Department of Health and Human Services and former Commissioner Mayhew on a Saturday, I think it was, and trying to talk about having a different way of providing some individual and group counseling within the correctional facility. But the thing that I continue to hear from those incarcerated is, you can have this great programming in your jail, but you've got to connect it to those that are released. How does it continue on? Don't let somebody walk out of the jail with a good tool and no toolbox to carry it in. So when they walk out, they need to go back to those same providers. And I don't normally advocate for one medical assisted treatment over another, as I'm still a cop, and hoping that those in the recovery world can figure out those. But I think there's a lot there. It is difficult in a correctional environment. 74% of the people in Penobscot County Jail are pretrial, which means they haven't been found guilty yet. And one of the things that I constantly hear from them
are it's very difficult to take advantage of any program that you have if you don't know your fate. If you're sentenced 6 months, 9 months, or a year, sitting in jail, not knowing when your release date is ever there, that's what you're constantly thinking about. And sometimes it's difficult to take care of those programs or take advantage of those programs. The other part of our program that we saw that had to make sense is we had to partner with local providers. If somebody is incarcerated at the Penobscot County Jail, but the provider's in Portland, it makes no sense that when they're released here in Bangor that they would have to go to Portland to get treatment. The same thing when they're released from the Bangor Jail and they're in Millinocket, how do they get to the treatment provider? So that goes back to the rural nature of what we're doing. We were the first county in the state that started this type program in the county jail. It's since been duplicated to others. And we hope that we do need our federal partners. We need some of that money. And I look back over here when we were talking about money, I didn't have my hand out. You know, we do need to have that funding to make sure that not only in the county jail, it's there, that after the release that it continues on.
Thank you. Chief Justice Stoffley, I'd like to turn to you really from the perspective of what you have seen with treatment through a drug court setting. But in addition, you and I had a conversation backstage before things began, and you were talking about the challenge often that you see of people who have disconnected with their family because of the power of addiction. And I think a lot of that conversation connected for me with what Dr. Gardner was sharing. Do you mind talking just a bit about what you see firsthand in families and that disconnection and the challenge that
sure, presents? Absolutely. And thank you so much for bringing us all together. I want to thank the senator and the congressman too. And I will, as I always do, put in a plug for the state of Maine. We are small enough and personal enough that we can, in fact, solve unsolvable problems, and coming together and having these conversations is where a lot of it begins. So I'm really grateful for everything everyone is doing here today. I want to start by talking about the way the community has responded to this crisis when there was nothing in place for response. So exactly as you heard from Courtney, from the doctor, from all of us, people are in crisis, and the only institutions we have that are required to take folks in these kinds of crises are our jails and Long Creek, where we're placing youth who are addicted or have mental health problems. And the interesting thing that I've watched over the last decade is that and I give Sheriff Morton enormous credit for this, the law enforcement community has gone from hang 'em high to help us help them. And it has made an enormous difference in how we're all looking at it. And I think as we begin to really get serious about this, it's going to make the biggest difference. What struck me as fascinating this morning is that we have a town manager whose job should be issuing permits for back decks and taking care of snow plows for the winter and making sure we're ready for whatever Maine weather brings us and all the other things that a town manager should be doing. And in fact, he's worrying about the individuals in his community who are struggling with addictions. That's what Maine's all about, and that's why we can solve this problem. But there are some huge issues that have to be addressed along the way. So before I talk about the family disconnect, let me just tell you one really disheartening conversation I had. First of all, every time Sheriff Morton and I are in a room together, he makes me want to lie down and sob because we are in the courts working desperately to reduce the number of people who are awaiting resolution of criminal charges in our jails. It's not effective. It's not where you go to get treatment. You can't get your life back in order. Everything's on hold. So we've been working and working and working to get those numbers down. And when he walks into this room and says 74%, I want to poke him in the eye. But that, I understand, is still illegal in oh so many ways. But here's that's the flip side of that. I had a conversation, I roam around the state and occasionally go into the jails and talk to people and have those same conversations. Why are you here? What could we have done earlier? What are we missing? And a young woman said to me, she said, I asked her why she was in jail at that time. She said she was awaiting trial on drug trafficking charges. And I said, are you getting treatment? And she said, I'm getting sober. The treatment is hard in the pretrial process. And I said, when will you talk to your attorney about bail? And she said, listen, lady, don't be getting me out of here on bail. I already had to convince my lawyer not to seek bail. And so I found a table and we sat down, and what she said to me was, the only place in the world that she knew she was safe was in the county jail. Because in the county jail, her dealer couldn't get to her. The person who she described to me as someone who is probably engaged in human trafficking couldn't get to her. And she had a chance to get sober. If that's how we're using our county jails, we are making a terrible, terrible mistake. But we also don't yet have a legal construct for housing that prevents the dealer and the trafficker from coming into the housing. And we need to be thinking about all of that continuum of housing along the way. So I just thank you. All right, I won't poke you in the eye in front of all of these witnesses. One of the things that we see with addiction is that it tears you away from every support system that you started with. It tears you away from your children, your parents, your community. The shame factor is absolutely out there. It tears you away from employment. It tears you away from any sense of self-esteem. And most particularly, and this is one of the things we're struggling with, it tears people away from their confidence that they can succeed. And so just seeing the success this morning is a wonderful thing, but that departure from all the ordinary human things, when you get up in the morning, what could I do that could be successful, means that an awful lot of what we're doing just is not taking. It's not helping. So one of the things that we've seen that does, in fact, create a connection, if we can get people healthy enough, is to return them to their family connections. It has to be done safely and carefully, but if you can begin to return children to visits with their parents and return adults to their parental and sibling community, you can begin to move toward health. So let me just talk to you for a second about some statistics, because everyone wants to know, why don't we just have drug courts everywhere? Why aren't the drug courts doing everything? The number of people in drug courts last year, 254 people all told at its highest level last year, compares to the number of Narcan doses given last year at 2,500 doses. Now, recognizing that some of those were multiple, we're talking about a very tiny proportion of the population. Compare the number of people who were successful in drug court in 2017, that's 51 people who graduated, to the number of people who died from overdoses, 418 people died. So what we're seeing is that 20 to 40% of the population in the drug courts every year fails. They cannot stay, they get sick, they die, they can't stay in the drug courts. The remaining people sometimes graduate. You saw 51 last year. If they graduate, the recidivism rate is incredibly low. The recidivism rate for graduates from drug court is hovering around 16, that's 16%. The recidivism rate for graduates of our veterans drug court approaches zero. It is so successful. So when we are successful, the news is great, but it's far too few people, and far too few people stay in the programs, including in the Family Recovery Court. Many of the parents who go into the program do not stay in the program, and more we are seeing parents who do not want to go into the Family Recovery Program because it's hard. So more power to you. It is difficult. There's a lot of adulting, as my now 30-year-old kids would tell you. You have to actually go to the appointments, do the work, stay sober, stay away from your friends, all of those things. So it's hard. So one of the things that we did was try to figure out what are the key, where are we succeeding with the drug courts, and what are the key aspects of those successes. And that led me to propose a wraparound drug court, which will be expensive and will tell us whether we're proposing a pilot wraparound drug court on the coast, probably two counties, possibly Knox, Lincoln, we're not really sure yet. The total cost, we think, for a it's gotta be a two-year program, and then there's gotta be long-term care afterwards. And we're thinking for that two-year period, it's a solid $2 million for the drug court to be successful. But in order to make a drug court really successful, you have to remember, and I learned a new phrase today that I will use regularly, which is episodic foresight, which I used to say with my 16-year-old is avoiding being a knucklehead. So think ahead. We all know that our youth get their full use of their frontal lobes by about 25. If you go into addiction before that, you're still 16 when you start to become sober. And you've got to learn all of that episodic foresight in order to make it work. But the one thing that we discovered when we went back to see who did well and why was that we had forgotten Maslow's hierarchy. And if you are trying to get sober and you don't know where you're going to sleep tonight, you're couch surfing, or you are at the mercy of your dealer who will provide you with a place to stay, you're doomed from the very beginning. So, and I will wrap this up with, here's the proposal for the wraparound drug court. It would include immediate access to the kind of housing that you need today, which may be a detox center right now, right this minute. It may be an intense after placement, which might actually lock others out, not necessarily you in, but others out. It may be longer term sober housing, and it must eventually accommodate families in reunification. So you're talking about a continuum of care in housing that would work. The second part is comprehensive case management, because that executive function isn't there yet. You need someone to remind you that you have an appointment today, that you have an interview with an employer, that you've got to get to the doctor or you've got to get to therapy, and you need that for quite a while. Treatment, obviously, is key. Addiction treatment, which we think we have in a variety of ways, but we need to connect. Necessary medical care, that is almost as important as housing. If you are ill because of any of the other things going on in your life, you cannot fight the addiction until you are healthy. Dental care has to be part of that. We hear over and over and over that the pain from youth of poverty and no dental care is amazingly distracting. Mental health treatment, you've all talked about that. You have to have regular and random testing. And if you don't test, you don't know and you can't help. You've got to have job training, employment assistance, education that goes with it. You really need family-related services to begin to return people to their support system. And you've got to have long-term follow-up to make it work. In the court system, different from the treatment community, we talk about personal accountability. And we mean it. If you're going to come into these programs, you've got to be accountable to yourself and everyone else. But we cannot require people to be accountable without the full toolbox that will let them be successful and accountable. So our hope is that sometime within the next year or so, the legislature will fund the wraparound drug court, and we will then know, is that the key to success for those who have had to come into the court system? I talked too long, I'm sorry.
Thank you for those comments and for your leadership and your vision. Before we turn to recovery, I want to take a minute and turn to Congressman Poliquin and Senator King. The administration has worked closely with members of Congress on addressing this important issue of increasing access to treatment, and we're very grateful for your assistance in this, particularly for resources in rural communities. Any additional thoughts about this piece, important piece of the puzzle?
Thanks, Ann, for the question. I remember when Jim was healthiest is when he was held accountable post-detox. And one of the ways that, you know, we all would deal with this issue from a sibling standpoint or a parent is one of the things he loved to do was go out to lunch because he was hungry often because of substance abuse. So what do you do when Sammy is 4 and I show up at his apartment not knowing what I'm going to find? So I only do it during the day. We don't do it at dinner, we go to lunch. And then if he was using, you could tell it and say, sorry, Jim, you gotta be sober. That's tough because now he's hungry. You know, he had violent behavior when he was high. So it's tough. So I'm listening to what Lee is saying. And you are spot on. You are absolutely spot on. You know, when these folks are struggling to get clean, they've got to be in a safe place to live away from bad actors. And families then will feel more wanting to stay connected to them. Jim was also happiest when he was working. And, you know, as time went on, he was less and less able to do that. And then it gets really bad. But if they can be employed, doesn't matter what it is, that is a huge part of therapy. Because it gives them that dignity and that self-worth and what have you. It gives them a future. It gives them something to look forward to. Because sometimes it's tough to get up in the morning and shower and shave and put on something clean and go to work for some people. And we got to help them do this. But you can't give up on them. You absolutely cannot give up on them. But I think it's a great idea, Lee, and it touches a lot of the things that, but anyway, I'm sorry.
Any thoughts, Senator? Okay.
First, I love it that you're taking lots of notes.
I don't write it down, you don't remember it.
She's been taking lots of notes, and that's great. I was supposed to make a plane an hour ago. I just got a note that the plane was an hour late. I don't think I've ever in my life been happy about a plane being late. But this has been a great conversation. It really has. And I've learned a lot and just had a couple of thoughts. This has been a great session. Appreciate your convening this. A couple things I've heard that I think are so important. Doctor, treat it like a disease. That's the beginning of wisdom, it seems to me, in terms of getting at this. And I that one phrase has really resonated with me. In terms of cost, as I travel the state and all over, Northern Maine, Eastern, I was over in Washington County over the week, last week, the number one economic problem facing Maine today is workforce. Every business I go to can't find enough people, including police forces, sheriffs, nursing homes, you name it. Everybody is looking for people. And I'm thinking about the cost, the $2 million. The problem is the cost of these programs goes in a budget. The cost of not doing them, you don't see. And that's what I think we have to keep in mind. Maine, because the opportunity cost to Maine, the lost people, forget about the you can put aside the humane part of it, just from the sheer economics of our state, we're stumbling because of a lack of manpower, and we're wasting people. Every person that is succumbs and isn't treated is a wasted life that isn't available to help our state move forward. And then, of course, the human cost is incalculable, the cost to the family. So I was very frustrated last year. We passed in the Congress with great fanfare, CARO, a comprehensive addiction recovery, with no money. It was like sending the fire department with no water. I mean, you know, we had this great structure, but there was finally money starting to flow. And I think the key thing for us here in Maine is to find our own models, and particularly in the rural areas, but to apply a cost accounting that doesn't count the cost of not doing it. It just seems to me is a false economy. So I do have to head over to the airport, but I want to thank all of you. This has been extraordinary. And I think we all ought to resolve that this is the beginning and not the end. We're going to keep doing this, try to reassemble different places, different people, because we've got to win this. The stakes are simply too high. So Anne, again, thank you for coming to Maine and leading us today, and I'll look forward to continuing to work with you.
Thank you, Senator. Let's turn from the treatment discussion into the final piece today, which is so important, and that's recovery. I think while there is certainly no silver bullet in this complex issue, we know that community, as has already been mentioned today by Mr. Paquette, is so essential to long-term prosperity for many struggling families. And I know from my own travels that this will look different in every rural community. Each community has different assets and different challenges. But we know that strong recovery network is so important to keeping people healthy and ultimately to making effective use of the treatment funding and that access to treatment that so many folks are focused on. Sheldon, I would like to turn to you and to look at what the state is really doing to meet the needs of people in recovery, and particularly looking at, we've heard some discussion about housing and the need for the opioid health home model. Can you talk about what that is and what's the driver behind that?
As a bureaucrat with Senator King and Congressman Poliquin, I can't help but share something that we bumped up against in our discussions with Troy and other county sheriffs around the state, and that is the hard line prohibition of having a Medicaid reimbursable service inside the jail. So we're using our state dollars right now.
That's something we ought to be able to fix.
That's something that I would certainly appreciate additional work on. But we've been using our state dollars in that Vivitrol pilot inside the jail, and then we can flip to our block grant and Medicaid dollars outside the jail. So that's something I'm really pleased with. We started with PCHC. And that partnership has been terrific. I think perhaps the most underutilized future resource are the FQHCs and the rural health centers and the critical access hospitals. We have to do a better job in partnering, both in terms of, I'm glad to hear that Catherine Power is here in the audience, but SAMHSA does know and publish what works best. And so, as we look at the treatment modalities, we know that medication-assisted treatment has the best outcomes. And we deployed those in this opioid health home model. Others refer to it as hub and spoke. Maine was, I think, the sixth state in the country to get permission from CMS to have that a Medicaid reimbursable service. That's a model that is growing rapidly, and it does deploy that concept of literally the hub and spoke. And we were involved in the rulemaking. My office had a seat at the table of the rulemaking of that model, and it allows for a lot of flexibility. And our, my partners in the Office of Maine Care Services are continuing to process new applications. I think that shows a lot of promise. The other real area of promise is our prescription monitoring program. Maine was one of the first states in the country with strong bipartisan support to put forward and define limits on acute and chronic pain. And although my epidemiologist wife cringes when I say this, the World Health Organization has identified the United States as the number one utilizer of hydrocodone. Over 95% of the world's supply goes to the United States. And in 2012, according to the CDC, the state of Maine had the number one per capita use of long-acting hydrocodone. So in my simple mind, that makes Maine number one in the world. But again, she cringes when I ever bring that up. I will say that you know, the Bangor Daily News just recognized Maine's prescription drugs through pharmacies fell 25% of opioids. It's a remarkable drop in the last year. And that's a result not just of words on a paper and a statute, but of pharmacists, physicians, and the entire community recognizing the need to do business differently. And we
What's
are.
That figure again? 25.
25% reduction.
Down.
1 year. It's quite astronomical. We should also, to put the context of medication-assisted treatment, my office, the 2016 budget, original budget, was $250,000 for medication-assisted treatment. Today, we're knocking on the door of $4.4 million. Because clearly, as demonstrated by SAMHSA, that's an evidence-based practice that works, that has the most success. And I have to put all of my statements in the context of Courtney's presentation this morning. Thank you for being here. Thank you for grounding us. Reminds all of us as to why we're here at the table and to work tirelessly towards improving care. I've heard housing. I'm an old housing person on the mental health side. And I should mention on the mental health side, Senator King, I appreciated the distinction between NIH and NIMH. 80% of the persons afflicted with mental illness have a co-occurring substance use problem. Housing and Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I recall in the old office of mental health under Governor King, being involved with then AMHI and later Riverview clinicians talking about the latest medicine. And I would hold up my hands and say, recovery only begins when a person is in safe, decent, affordable housing. It can't happen inside a hospital. It can't happen in a shelter. So I hear loud and clear the, and I know loud and clear the importance of housing. We've been using data-driven decision-making. My colleague, who's also in the audience, Catherine Kutu, and I presented at the first National Opioid Conference in Baltimore last year. We weren't certainly the first state to hotspot the opioid epidemic, but we were one of the first to use that data in the allocation of resources. And the $2 million in state targeted response funding largely went to four counties, Washington, Aroostook, Penobscot, and Cumberland. I'm not going to spout all the statistics that are in my head right now, but I can say clearly that Washington County is still impacted most severely in opioid deaths on a per capita basis. oftentimes more than twice as high as Cumberland in York County. Penobscot County continues to be afflicted with drug-affected babies, again, at multiple folds higher than other counties in the region. So we know we can and must do better. I think I want to close sort of where I opened, again, by thanking Courtney, and I also want to underscore the importance of deploying the evidence that we have. SAMHSA actually has a website on evidence-based best practices, and I encourage folks to tap Catherine Power on the shoulder. She probably has that off the top of her head. I do not. And Anne, thank you for pulling us together. I have to admit, I never thought of USDA as a partner. But given our industries in forestry and fishing, as Congressman Poliquin was mentioning earlier, and your statistic, what did you say, 74% is astounding. And so we're certainly doing that in Maine, too. We're looking forward to future business partnerships.
Thank you, Sheldon.
Anybody else want to fly to Maine to Washington right now? Thank you again.
Sheldon, thank you, Senator. I think with your comments on about housing, I think that's a great segue to Mr. Campbell. Bruce, if you could share, we often see a correlation in addition to the need that's been highlighted today, I think between people that are experiencing homelessness and substance misuse. So could you talk a bit about the BARN initiative? What's that all about?
Sure.
Who are some of the key partners? What are you working on?
Okay, well, the BARN stands for the Bangor Area Recovery Network. And that's exactly what it is. It's a network of people in recovery and recovery allies. And our mission is to basically support the recovery process. So like you, Courtney, I'm a man in recovery. And I've got to tell you, 10 years ago, neither one of us would be here on this panel. That's just the way it is. And so I'm very heartened by the fact that recovery at least is getting some of its due. Unfortunately, Senator King left just before I had a chance to say, we do have the data that shows what happens when we don't do it. The Surgeon General came out with a report, 2015, and if I were just to take the population ratio for Maine, we would have an economic impact of substance use in the state of Maine of $1.8 billion. And so of that, now the last time we measured how much were we invested in prevention and treatment was in 2010. And at that point, we were investing less than 4% in prevention and treatment. And the rest were in medical costs, criminal justice costs, lost productivity, and all of those things. So we do have that data. And I would love to see the real micro data for the state of Maine that came out of the Surgeon General's report. Because I think then, you know, if we turn to Sheldon and say, okay, well, how's our percentage in investments on treatment and recovery increasing? We would be surprised to see, hopefully we'd be surprised to see that increase has gone up. But research also shows that recovery results in a reduction in criminal justice costs of 10 to 1. Recovery results in a reduction of medical costs of 10 to 1. All of the negative assets, negative consequences of substance abuse decrease, and the assets of employment, education, starting your own business, civic engagement, family involvement, all increase. So the return on investment in investing in recovery is dramatic. I am extraordinarily proud of the Bangor Area Recovery Network and what it has been able to accomplish to this date with zero state or federal funding. We were able to secure and purchase and renovate a community recovery center in an old furniture store that is now open 7 days a week from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. It's staffed primarily by volunteers. We have two half-time paid employees, but we generate somewhere between 800 and 900 volunteer hours every single month. 2 years ago, we started a housing program called Holyoke Haven, which is about a block and a half away from the actual community recovery center, and it provides safe and sober and affordable housing for 13 women. At the same time, right across the street, we've recently gained access to another sober housing opportunity at 7 Holyoke Place. This summer, we are embarking upon another initiative around workforce, where we have two AmeriCorps volunteers who are going to be working at the barn to really try and help shepherd people into the workforce as they come there. One of the best things that I can say about the barn is, when all else fails, and I hate to say it that way, because I think we should have treatment upon demand. I think we should be able to treat substance use disorders like other medical disorders and say, if you've got it, you can get help for it. But at least we can now say, well, have you gone to the barn? Have you checked that out? Because it's a zero barrier to access operation. And people can walk in the door and immediately be greeted and asked how they're doing. And there's four pillars that the barn stands on. We call it the four pillars of the barn's foundation. The first one being is that recovery is a process. And it's not something that just happens, like, you know, overnight. And actually, we've heard it today, that treatment is not recovery in and of itself, but treatment happens, or recovery happens after treatment, or treatment's a launching pad for recovery. The second pillar is that there are many pathways to recovery. Whether it's medication, whether it's a traditional treatment program, whether it is 12 steps, whether it is standing on your head, it's okay. Now, we will support that pathway to recovery. The only thing we require at the barn is you keep the drugs out of there and no violence. Other than that, it's a very welcoming environment. Third is recovery overcomes shame and stigma. Okay. I would dare say I would not be able to be here today if it were not for my recovery. Like it was said earlier, my recovery has enabled me to go back to school, to have a career, to raise a family, to own a home. That's a long stretch from when I was living in a school bus with one spigot of running water. And then fourthly, and this is the part that I can't emphasize enough, and that is that supporting recovery is a community responsibility. It really is a community responsibility, and that's one of those things where I just look at the barn and I just marvel sometimes at the level of community support. The support we've gotten from Congressman Poliquin, support we've gotten from Sheriff Morton. Across the board, the community has stepped up and said, how can we help? The city of Brewer has been absolutely spectacular in their support of our sober housing programs. They've actually enabled us to put a new roof on the Victorian building that we have for Holyoke Haven, you know, and also put new siding on it, new windows. So those are just some of the examples of what happens. But more than anything else, what the barn is, it's a vessel and a container for the recovery process, because there's something magic that happens when there's the old saying is one drunk talking to another, right? And when they realize that they're just not in it for the game, but part of what happens is when you give back, you get. And that seems to be a whole lot of what goes on there.
Thank you, Bruce, for those comments about what it's like working on the ground in a community, but also I think the hope and encouragement that you share. I want to turn to Barbara. To get a perspective, I guess, on what this means for families. I think we've heard a lot today about the impact on children, but as we think about somebody coming out of treatment and is in recovery, what do all of those pieces that come into a family's life mean for your work at the Godparents Home?
Yeah, the Shepherd Godparent Home, we have four programs in our ministries, and we are a faith-based ministry, and we take no state or federal funding. We are supported by area churches, civic organizations, individuals that really see the need in our community to help women get back on their feet, recovering from a lot of different crises. What we do see a lot has been talked about today is, you know, looking at that that need. What does Maslow's theory tell us? Where do we begin with the women we serve? And so we are a shelter, but we're residential. So what that means is you're not waiting every day to see if you've got a bed. Your bed is yours until you're through the process and ready to be independent in the community. Many of our women come to us when they're pregnant. We do baseline drug testing at that point, and we help them get clean. And we help them with sobriety supports. And we start with a psychosocial assessment. What happened in your childhood? What type of abuse have you endured? What are your basic needs right now? And someone mentioned teeth. I mean, that is just like, that's huge. My background was working with families that I helped take apart instead of put back together in child welfare. And so, you know, I often wondered, how do you attend to the all these things everybody wants you to attend to when you're in chronic pain? We start with things like teeth. Now, we don't bill main care, and we don't take any funding, so we write grants, like Delta Dental has given us grants to fix the women's teeth so that they can find employment and they can get back on their feet. So we start with those things. We provide them with a beautiful residential program in Bangor and help them through their pregnancies. Then we have a newborn shelter. Nikki's Hope is our program for parenting moms. That was born of a tragedy of one of our residents. We didn't have a parenting program. We only helped through the pregnancy area. And Nikki was a young woman murdered here in Bangor over a drug deal, triple homicide. And she was one of our residents. And she'd made tremendous progress. She was a product of the child welfare system. She had a lot of childhood trauma. And when she left our program, she went back to her natural resources. And what we really, really want to do is change what those natural resources are for the women in our care. So we work on developing natural supports in the community for them. You know, the history of social work is the church used to be the social worker. And somewhere along the line, we started believing government could do it better, and I dare say they can't. That, you know, we as a community can get behind people and really work with them. So Nikki's Hope was born of that tragedy. So now we have this transition apartment where young women can stay with their babies, grow in their parenting, their faith work, their sobriety, and they can take a year to make good housing choices, not to move into the worst neighborhoods that are going to put them at risk. We require, if they don't have diplomas, they have to work on diploma or GED while they reside in our programs. Then we have a vocational specialist that works on employment. How about post-secondary education? Many of them have never even considered that education post-secondary would be an option for them. So we work on that piece. We have a partnership with Center for Family Medicine, working with residents to talk to them about the needs of our women, and they come in and do training. So we do those pieces. We do random drug testing, sobriety supports. We have a clinician that comes in. We bring most of our services in so that the women aren't missing appointments and those sort of things. We provide them with transportation to everything they need to go to. And like the barn, we have 3 full-time employees and about 70 active volunteers that run the program. And that is our community here that is doing that for these women. And we provide them everything from their deodorant to the clothes on their back, everything they'll need for their baby. We want to make sure that we help keep families together. We work in conjunction with the Department of Health and Human Services, Maine State Housing Authority, a whole variety of programs. And I want to get back to something Christine said. Christine and I worked years ago in child welfare, so she can really see where I'm coming from about that prenatal exposure. We work with a really unique population, and you know, the prenatal exposure from all substances impacts long-term that multi-generational dysfunction. And you know, Sheriff Morton gets to see those young people who don't have frontal good reasoning because they've been prenatally exposed, and then they end up in your jail. And so for us, we really want to be on that front end to make sure we get into a place where we can work with women so that there's not that prenatal exposure. And one of the things that we've noticed since the legalization of recreational marijuana here in the state of Maine is that we are seeing an increase of women who are pregnant and using marijuana. So they see it as kind of a benign thing because it's legal. And it took us years and years to train women to avoid alcohol use during pregnancy. And now I feel like we're going to be on that same road to really talking to them about that exposure to THC and the risk for their children and the behavioral problems that come from that prenatal exposure. And those are some of the things that we're doing to really, we target each individual client. We look at their specific need and their history and are able to address their needs, not based on billable hours, but based on the individual. And so we also, you know, a huge component of that is giving them faith in something bigger than themselves.
Thank you, Barbara. Rick, I'm going to turn to you for the last.
I've got to follow Barbara.
I know. I saw her wink at me. He was like, which one of us is going to be first?
Well, my thought in wrapping this conversation as we move really from conversation, from talking to action, I come to you because of the platform that you hold. That as someone working in broadcasting and someone who is respected for your commitment to issues that are of importance to Mainers, would love to get your perspective on some of the key takeaways from today and what your thoughts might be about how we move from a dialogue into coordination and action.
One of the key takeaways from today is within this room there is a great deal of unity. After listening to the panelists, after gathering some of the knowledge I'm sure that everyone sitting here today has, you all have an understanding as to how we've come to fall prey to this. But my concern is, once we walk outside these doors, I think we might be encountering the same people that we see or that we hear from every day, the people who are frustrated. The perception is, we're spending more money on enforcement, we're spending more money on education, we're spending more money on treatment, and we're still losing the battle. And we're still losing one person every day. And that the people outside the doors here are the same people that are frightened. They're frightened because the next death that they learn of could be a neighbor, or could be a friend, or could be a family member. When you have a husband and wife that work in law enforcement, they are on the front lines, and they lose a son to addiction, and then lose their second son to addiction. You can understand why people are afraid, not just that someone's going to break into their car or break into their home for money, for drugs. They're afraid they're going to lose someone and they'll be called to the next funeral. And outside these doors today, there are people who are furious. They're furious when they hear elected leaders arguing. I want to crack down. You want to hurt the victims. No, I want to go after the dealers. I want to fight the disease, not the symptoms. People see through it. What people want is faith that we can find solutions. Have you been to Disney World? If any of you have gone as a kid, or maybe your kids dragged you there, or maybe your grandkids dragged you there, you always went to the Peter Pan ride. And as an adult, you stood there and you saw the sign that said 45-minute wait. But do you know what Disney did? They set up the series of ropes and stands. Do you know why Disney did that? Because you started walking through the ropes and the stands, and their research found that if people are moving forward, they feel like they're getting somewhere. You show people your progress, and they will be patient for the promise. Oh my gosh, Trip Gardner just picked up his pen, he wrote it down. I'm gonna work on Chief Justice Lee Sofley now. If you show, poking in the eye, aren't you? If you show people the progress, they will be patient for the promise. Let me word it differently. If you show people the Courtney Allens, they will be patient for the promise. This morning on the radio, I said maybe we'll stumble across some solutions here this morning. I wasn't hopeful, and I don't think maybe we've heard about some, but I don't know if we have. I don't know what the solutions are, or how costly or how complex they're going to be, but I can tell you this. I know why we haven't found our solution yet. Because we don't want it badly enough. Ma'am, you're in Bangor, Maine. In January of 1911, we burned down our downtown. We rebuilt our downtown in less than 2 years. Try to build any building in a downtown district in less than 2 years today. How did Bangor do it? We wanted it badly enough. Until we crave a solution to addiction, as much as an addict who is gripped by the monster of addiction craves their next fix, we're going to be right here. We need to be addicted to finding the solution. Or we'll never find the solution to addiction. I went over time, didn't I? Oh, no, 12:35.
Thank you, Rick. I cannot think of a more fitting closing.
These people were just clapping because we're done on time. That's, I know, man.
I want to close today with a heartfelt thank you, and I guess to go back where we began this morning, which is just my deep appreciation for everyone that is here today and for sharing the stories in your communities and in your state. I'm truly grateful for this opportunity to learn from you, to hear frankly about the challenges, about the opportunities for further action, and the examples of some of those things that are working in communities. I believe in what I have seen is that people are looking for that silver bullet, and in reality, oftentimes it is the small things that are happening piece by piece. Things like, what is the level of connection in a given town? And those are difficult issues to embrace, but I believe that ultimately that's where a lot of the answers lie. I want to thank Senator King and Congressman Poliquin for making the time to be here with us today. I know you have an incredibly busy schedule, and I appreciate all that you juggled to be here. Do you have anything in closing that you'd like to add? Okay, well with that, I'll close with a thought from my home state of Indiana. Our governor there, Eric Holcomb, has been a tireless advocate on this issue, and he often describes the opioid crisis as a battle for life. And at USDA, I want you to know that we stand with you as leaders in this monumental battle. I know that working together, we can build healthy and prosperous communities now and for generations to come. So thank you again for your attendance, and we are here as your partner.